Thank you for new life in you. Lord, we thank you for the young lives of those who we've just seen go out into Sunday school, those who we've kind of admitted into the main service. Lord, we thank you for the children and young people that we have in our lives. And thank you that you want to make us new as well. Lord, I pray that as we're at the start of a new year, that you would do something new in us. Father, that the things that we hear this morning would help us to chart the course for where you want us to go throughout this year. May the things that we learn now be put into practice and see as good through to 2023 and however many years that you have beyond for us too. So Holy Spirit, help me as I speak and help us as we listen. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, do you wonder where you'll be this time next year? Sometimes when we get to the end of a year, we become very contemplative, don't we? We look back and we analyze where we've come from. Some of us have regrets, some of us have aspirations, and we wonder where we'll be. What sort of man will I be? What sort of dad will I make when our child comes? How will I do at this new school or in a new year? When my job changes? How will things go? Where will I be next year? And as Christians, we ask a question often, and it's right, and we ask, what's God's will for my life? We ask, what's God's will for my life in 2022, or 363 days of it that are left? What does God want for me? We want to know God's will, and sometimes we really stress out over it. Have you been in that place where you've really been like, oh, I want to know what God wants for me? And it becomes a real big thing, and you get so worked up over it. Well, this morning I want to offer some principles so that we can know, when we reach 2023, that we are in the middle of God's will. Some guiding principles for us. Now, the Bible offers very different life principles to what the world offers, doesn't it? Very different. One key one that came up in the past few years was this idea of you do you. Put your hand up if you've heard that phrase, you do you. Okay, good, good. So you do you basically means do whatever makes you happy. You do you. And what I want to say for us today as we go into 2022 is in 2022, don't do you, do him. Do Jesus. Do what he wants to do. Do what makes him happy. And in so doing, we'll somehow find that it's what satisfies us as well. In 2015, Justin Bieber released a song, Love Yourself. Now, when I was in high school, I really didn't like him because all the girls liked him. So it wasn't cool for me to like Justin Bieber. He's a singer, in case you didn't know. And this song, Love Yourself, it's this, the idea is he has a girlfriend and she's really self-absorbed. She doesn't really give him much attention. She's mean to him. And it seems like she prefers her own company than his. And in the chorus, he says, well, if you like the way you look that much, well, darling, you should go and love yourself. And when he sang that, he made that out to be something that was negative. Oh, well, go and love yourself. But the world now has adopted love yourself as something positive, hasn't it? You see it on all kinds of products. You see it in adverts. Love yourself. Give self-love. One blog recommended several steps to loving yourself. Two of them were these. I did pick out the most outrageous ones because I'm a preacher and that's what we do. But two of the steps recommended to love yourself were take yourself out on a date. Sounds a bit bizarre to me, but there we are. That's what it recommended. And the other one was write a love letter to yourself. Now, the words of Jesus, which are eternally true and stand and valid, whether we're in ancient times or right now today, are in stark contrast to what this idea of loving yourself and self-love has to say. And he said that the way to glorify God and simultaneously have a fulfilling life is actually to deny ourselves, to die to ourselves. Now, it's been a few weeks since we've been in Luke's gospel. And last time we were, We read about the story of Jesus feeding the 5,000 men with two fish and five loaves. And that ended what is known as Jesus' Great Galilean Ministry. He spent a lot of time around Lake Galilee. But as we come into the section that we're at now from verse 18 that Marg read for us, Jesus now begins his journey to Jerusalem. We read elsewhere that Jesus set his face like a flint to go to Jerusalem. He was determined. And this point in verse 18 marks that change. This would be a time of relative retirement from the crowds with his disciples as he prepared them for what lay ahead. And we know what lay ahead, don't we? The road would get rough. Jesus would be betrayed, falsely accused, and put to death. The road would be rough, and Jesus was preparing his disciples for that. As we are setting aside this morning, may God prepare us for 2022. It might be a great year. It might be a really difficult year. We might not see much of it. Jesus may return. Our lives might end. We don't know. But may he prepare us for what he has for us this year through his words this morning. So if you want to be fulfilled, and if you want to know what God's will for your life is this year, then I believe that the answer to both of these things is found in the words of Jesus. So in 2022, don't do you, do him. And we'll read verse 18 to 20 again. Now it happened that as he was praying alone, the disciples were with him, and he asked them, "Who do the crowds say that I am?" And they answered, "John the Baptist, but others say Elijah, and others that one of the prophets of old is risen." Then he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" And Peter answered, "The Christ of God." So do him. Follow Jesus. Deny self. Do what he wants and follow him. Why? Because of who he is. Jesus had taken his disciples away from the crowds up to an area called Caesarea Philippi. It's right out the north of Israel, and it's the place where the Jordan River has its head, so it springs from there. It was a place of worship. There was temples there to the emperor. There was a temple to the god Baal, and there was a temple to the god Pan, the guy who looks like a goat and plays panpipes. So there was all this worship going on there. And this is where Jesus takes his disciples to. And he asks them, "Who do the crowds say that I am?" And we read there the answers, all kinds of different things, all kinds of different people for various reasons. Jesus was a prophet, wasn't he? Although he was more than a prophet. Jesus challenged the people of his day to repent, although he did more than that, and he allowed them to do so by his power inside. But he asked, "Who do people say that I am?" People today say Jesus many different things, don't they? What do people think about Jesus? Some people say he didn't exist. That's not historical, but some people say it. Some people say he was just a good teacher, maybe even the greatest of the teachers. In Islam, he is one of the great prophets, though not the greatest prophet, that was Muhammad. And we see then, we can't base our understanding of who Jesus is on what's most popular. If you want to follow Jesus, if you want to know him, you won't be popular. If we want to know who he really is, we won't find that from what the popular opinion says. Jesus goes on to ask the most foundational question when he says, "But who do you say that I am?" And the timing was really important, wasn't it? As we said, things would get really rocky in Jesus' ministry. The disciples would increasingly have to face scorn for following him. The Pharisees would increasingly be vehement against him. Things would get more and more and more tense. So it was important that the disciples knew who this one was, who they were following. And Peter, answering Jesus' question, probably speaking on behalf of the disciples, says, "You are the Christ of God." What does that mean? Sometimes we feel that, or we make out that Christ is Jesus' surname. It's not, is it? Christ is his office. As we talked about at Christmas, Christ comes from the Greek word, Christos, and it's the same as the Hebrew word, Messiah or Mashiach. And what that speaks of is when a king would be appointed, and the way they'd sort of set him up in their ceremony was they'd get some oil and they'd anoint his head. So Christ means the anointed one of God, the one who's promised, the king who's coming. And Peter says, you're the Christ of God. It was a landmark moment. From the point that Peter had made that declaration that Jesus was the Christ, everything would change in his life. In Matthew's gospel, Jesus goes on to say, yes, I am, and you're Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. And so a whole new age would begin from his declaration of Jesus being the Christ. Their lives would be changed. They'd follow him through all their lives. Most of them here would pay the ultimate price for saying that Jesus is the Christ of God. And it's a question that, I don't know whether the exact words will be used, but it's almost like when we'll stand before God after we die, this will be all that matters. Who do you say that Jesus is? Have you followed him? Have you given your life to him? Everything else will fade into comparative non-importance compared to this question, who do you say that I am? And we might say, well, Jesus is the Christ. It's easy to say, isn't it? But we also affirm it in the way that we live. We answer this question every day by what we believe and what we do. If we really believe that Jesus is who he says he is, it'll affect the way that I live. If I think that Jesus is the one who's sent from God for me to come and live and die for me, then it makes a difference every day, doesn't it? Who do you say that I am? If I was to ask that question to every individual in this room, what would your answer be? And what would your life say to that? May it be that we say the same as Peter and like, yes. And I'll do you, Jesus. I'll follow you because of who you are. You're the one who's come down from heaven for the whole world, yes, but also for me, to save me. Realizing and believing that Jesus is the Christ changes everything. And we want to not do us. We don't want to be those who do you do you, but to do him, to please him, to deny ourselves and follow Jesus because of who he is, but also because what he did for us. And we see that in verse 21. He strictly charged and commanded them to tell this to no one. Now just stop there and put yourselves in the disciples' shoes. You have this landmark moment. Peter, kind of heading up the band of brothers, has said, yes, Jesus, you are the Messiah. You're the one we've waited for thousands of years. And then, you know, you expect the balloons to drop from the ceiling and the fanfare to go. But what does Jesus say? He doesn't say, yes, go out and tell it on the mountains. He strictly charged and commanded them to tell this to no one. Bite your tongues, disciples. I'm the Christ, but tell no one. Why did Jesus say that? Surely he wanted everybody to know that he's the Christ. Well, just before this event, in John's gospel, Jesus preached a sermon and he said, I am the bread of life. I'm the bread come from heaven. If people eat of me, then they'll have life. People believe and receive me, they'll have life. And many people, just before that sermon, had wanted to take Jesus as king, take him by force. You've heard it preached before that the Jewish understanding of the Messiah didn't take into account so much that he'd come and suffer and die, but it was looking more on his coming as king to reign. And is he coming as king to reign? Yes, he is. But they focused more on that to the neglect of him coming to die for us, to be the suffering servant. And so if Jesus' disciples had gone out and told it on the mountains and taken a little boat and sailed down the River Jordan and said, Jesus is the Christ, then it's likely that many people would, you know, take him by storm. And that isn't what Jesus came to do first time, is it? He came first to deal with sin, and he'll come again to save us and save the world. So that's why he said that. But also, the Gentiles would not be saved apart from what would come in verse 22. Jesus was Jewish. We shouldn't forget that. He was born to a Jewish mother and Jewish father. He was the Jewish Messiah. He came to his own, but his own didn't receive him, did they? And that was all part of God's plan, so that his offer to save us, to change our hearts, to give us eternal life and hope and peace and forgiveness with God may be offered to everybody, not just those of a national family, but to the family of the human race. But also Jesus said, don't tell anybody this because of what's said there in verse 22. The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, and on the third day be raised. Jesus would be king. Jesus would become king of people's hearts, wouldn't he? He'd rise to heaven and be the king that we are worshipping now. And one day he will be king over all the earth and he'll restore it. But he would not be king without the cross. Remember, Satan, in his temptation of Jesus in the wilderness, said, if you'll just bow down to me, I'll give all the kingdoms of this world to you. Satan tempted Jesus with the crown without the cross. But Jesus wanted to go there. In fact, he said, the Son of Man must suffer many things. He must do so. If we would be saved, if you'd be made right with God, then the Son of Man must suffer and be betrayed and be killed and rise. He must do so. This was the way. 1 Peter 1, verses 18 to 20 talk about this, where it says that we have been redeemed with the precious blood of Christ, like a lamb without blemish or spot. He was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest in the last times for the sake of you who believe. From before the foundation of the world, this was God's plan. He must suffer. And Jesus wasn't going to allow some, you know, political, hooray, we found the Christ, to derail that. He loved us too much to do that. Jesus loved us too much to remain in heaven in the glory and the wonder and the joy and the beauty and the peace of heaven. He loved us too much to remain there, but he came down here into the mess, into a world that's dark a lot of the time, into a world of disease and death, because he loved us so much. And Jesus would not allow his disciples to, you know, put him on one of these thrones and carry them on their shoulders and marching through Jerusalem, because he must go to the cross, because he did that for us in love. In love, Jesus put us first through his death. And so that is what brings Jesus then to say what he does in verse 23. And that is our motivation for what I'm suggesting for us this morning. Don't do you. Don't just do what is easiest and most convenient and happiest for you in 2022. Do him. Follow him. And you know, if you're following him today, and you decide, I'm going to follow Jesus daily, I'm going to deny myself daily and do what he wants to do, then do you know that next week, you'll be in the middle of God's will. And you know that next month and next year, you'll be in the middle of God's will, because you've decided, Lord, each day, with your help, I'm going to just say no to what I prefer and yes to what you say. And that is life. Following Jesus is life. In verse 23, we read in the other Gospels that Jesus says this to the crowds as well, not just to the disciples, but as it says in Luke, he said it to all. If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. There were plenty of people that hung around Jesus. Some people wanted to get a free lunch, remember the loaves and fishes? Some people wanted to see a nice trick, like Herod. There were many people that were kind of in Jesus' broader fan club. But Jesus said, if you really want to follow me, this is what it would look like. Deny yourself. If you want to be a disciple, do this. Warren Wiersbe, thinking about this word disciple and discipleship, said that the closest idea that we have to that in English today is an apprentice. A disciple is more than a student who learns lessons by means of lectures and books. He is one who learns by living and working with his teacher in a daily hands-on experience like an apprentice does. He goes on to say, too many Christians are content to be listeners who gain a lot of knowledge, but who have never put that knowledge into practice. Do you want to be an apprentice of Jesus? Or do you want to be somebody who just can tell you all about him, but doesn't really follow him? We want to be the first, don't we? We want to be those who follow him, a disciple, an apprentice of him. Well, how do we do this? Jesus said, let that person deny themselves. What does that mean, to deny yourself? Well, pretty obvious, really, but just to broaden that out a bit, sometimes when you're reading the Bible, it's helpful to find where words are used in other places. So where else is the word deny used? It's used about Peter at Jesus' trial. And Jesus said to Peter, there's going to come a time when you'll deny me three times. And he did, didn't he? Peter was like, Jesus? Who's Jesus? I don't know that guy. Never even heard of him. So if we take that idea and then say, deny ourselves, Matt, who's Matt? Matt doesn't matter. Who's he? I disown any connection with myself. I'm saying, like, I don't even know you. But I know Jesus. It means to set aside one's own rights to his life. It's to say, I'm not my own because I've been bought with a price. And this is very different, isn't it, to what we're told? Very different. We're told to look out for number one, because if you don't love yourself, then who's going to love you? But Jesus says, no, if you want to follow me and follow me as life, then deny yourself. Where Matt's got a preference, and, you know, preferences aren't bad in themselves, are they? But where I've got a preference that is contradicting what Jesus wants for me, then I have to choose, am I going to do that or am I going to do Jesus? Am I going to do you or am I going to do him? To deny yourself, well, if self is out of the equation, then you become an others-centered person. More important to you than your own comfort becomes the good of others. And that's love, isn't it, really? To put others' good ahead of your own. It's not self-love. It's not writing love letters to yourself and taking yourself out on a date. It's putting others first. Now, as a little caveat, am I saying then that we should totally run ourselves ragged, not bother taking care of ourselves or even care of our families? That's not what I'm saying. If it is that Jesus has died to buy the whole of me, my body, soul, and my spirit, but my body included, then I will want to look after this body, won't I? I will want to put into it food that's good for it. I won't want to go to McDonald's every day and have a supersized meal. I will want to do a little bit of exercise. I will want to rest and look after this body because really it's not mine. It belongs to God. So it doesn't mean that you'll be an idiot, you know. You will do what you do in obedience to God, but your motive won't be just doing what makes you happy. Your motive will be him. Jesus said, if anyone would come after me, when he spoke it, and also this year, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Sometimes when we hear, or maybe we say the phrase, it's my cross to bear, it's the cross I've got to take up. And often we use that to talk about maybe your spouse, a boss that you have, or maybe some kind of illness. And we say, it's the cross I've got to bear. Well, when Jesus said, take up your cross, his audience knew exactly what he meant, because they would see people taking up their cross. And when somebody takes up their cross, it ends shortly after, because to take up the cross means to die. Nobody picked up a cross who wouldn't then be crucified on it. So Jesus is saying, die to yourself. It's as if when we decide to follow Jesus, Matt gets buried. And I etch in my tombstone, here lies Matt. Matt's dead. And that sounds weird, doesn't it, really? But this is exactly what the Apostle Paul said in a couple of places. In Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20, he said, I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. And in 1 Corinthians 15:31, he said this, I die every day. For Paul, and he's not an idol, he's a human who got stuff wrong, but he decided that each day, my preferences, my comfort is going to die, and Jesus is going to live through me. So if I could be cheesy, I'd say, be less James Bond, don't die another day, and be more Paul, die daily. So Jesus said that, take up your cross daily and follow me. And that's life, isn't it? It's a day-to-day decision. You might be really overwhelmed about what the year's going to bring, but decide each day, Jesus, I'm going to live for you. And you know that no matter what comes in between, that come the end of the year, you'll be in the middle of his will. So let him take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it. And me, sometimes it's easy for a preacher to say things because, you know, you've kind of rehearsed what you're going to say and you've thought about it so long that it doesn't, almost like the freshness of it wears off sometimes. But maybe you're sitting and thinking that, well, that doesn't sound very good. I'd rather live a life that's good for me. I'd rather save my life. Well, Jesus said, whoever would save his life will lose it. You might be thinking, well, I'll live for Jesus when I've had a little bit of fun. You know, maybe when I'm older. And I'm sure we can all think, when I'm older, I'll do this. No matter how old you are, you always think, well, tomorrow I'll do it. Whoever would save his life will lose it. Imagine if my life is a seed. Now, and then I bury that seed in the ground. It's gone. But I haven't lost it, have I? I haven't lost it. I've buried it, and I've then set it free to be what it was always intended to be. Bury your life. Let it be what God always intended it to be, for you to be. Let's do that through this year. And Jesus goes on to say, whoever loses his life, buries it in the ground, by my example, for my sake, will save it. It'll be real life to follow him and to die to yourself. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses or forfeits himself? What would you like to get out of this year? You know, maybe like to earn a bit of money. You'd like to get a promotion, you'd like your family to do well. Well, if you took all of those things and multiplied them by everything that's on the earth, but you neglected Jesus, that would be to your loss. For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words, of him will the Son of Man be ashamed when he comes in his glory, and the glory of the Father, and the glory of the holy angels. Jesus is coming back. And so we have that negative side of like, I don't want Jesus to be ashamed of me. But we also spin that round. I want to live a life that puts a smile on God's face. I'm not going to earn points with him because I stand in grace, don't I? I'm accepted because of that. But I want my life daily to be something that's like, yes, okay, Matt, that was good. Jean, yes, you did the right thing there today. Isaac, great, fantastic. And we can do that through God's help. And then Jesus wrapped up this little section where he said, I tell you truly, there are some standing here who won't taste death until they see the kingdom of God. And to explain that, you'll have to wait till next week. But if you could do all those things, get a promotion, have a great time, travel, you know, really build on your friendships, do well at school, whatever it might be, but not grow in likeness to Christ, it's a loss. You know the Ken Dodd song? Well, I'm going to ask you to fill in the line. When you go measuring a man's success, don't count money, count happiness. Okay, great. So I just want to rehash that song, that line of it anyway. When you go measuring your success, don't count money, count Christ's likeness. It's cheesy, I know, but I think it's true. When you go measuring your success this year, don't count money, count Christ's likeness. How has Jesus been at work in your life? How have you seen ways where you've chosen, like, it's painful, Lord, but I'm going to say no to myself and follow you? How are you going to see that this year? This is the way to live in 2022. We can know God's will and know that we'll be where he wants us to be come next year by being where he wants us to be each day. Not doing us, but doing him. And the way to real fulfilling life while also glorifying God is by dying to ourselves. Got one little story and then we'll bring the message to a close. And you're probably familiar with it. I only know some scant details that I stole off the internet. But on December the 11th, 1936, our then king put out an announcement on the radio. He'd been ruling for less than a year, but it's Edward the 8th, and he decided to voluntarily abdicate the throne. And he chose to do that after the British government, the public, and the Church of England condemned his decision to marry an American divorcee, Wallace Warfield Simpson. So he gave this address on December the 11th, and he said, I found it impossible to carry on the heavy burden of responsibility and to discharge the duties of king as I would wish to, without the help and support of the woman I love. Now, whether you agree with his decision or not, because of the woman that he loved, he chose to abdicate the throne to be with her. Because of the love of Jesus, may we step down from the throne of our lives and let him rule this year. We'll find it fulfilling. We'll find that we are in the middle of God's will. And I think it's a great way to start this year, so may God help us to do it. Amen. We're going to take some time to pray together, and what I